whenever I use the term reform in Islam, I emphasize that it should be specified and clarified. We're not speaking of a Protestant Reformation kind of change here, because Islam doesn't need that sort of change. Protestant Reformation was a reaction against a Catholic Church, which was unifying Christianity in a hegemonic way. So Protestants were reacting against that. That is not exactly our problem today in the Muslim world. But we need reform in the sense of transforming our religious tradition according to the realities of the modern world, 21st century, let's say. I think we Muslims need to understand that we have a legal tradition, just like in Judaism, the halakha, which was rooted in the divine. It was rooted in the Quran and the Prophet's sayings. But even those Quranic injunctions and the prophetic sayings and their interpretation by classical scholars had a context. It was a world in which slavery was there as normal. There was no international law. There was no idea that you could be a free person and practicing your religion under a state which is not Islamic. You know, that's why you had to expand the Islamic states. I mean, there are some Muslims who will still defend slavery today, but they are very extreme. Even the most conservative scholars, you know, would say, oh, you know, the Quran and the Hadith speak of slavery because there was slavery at the time, but the intention of Islam was to abolish slavery. So that's why God has verses praising the freeing of a slave. So Islam encouraged freeing of slaves. Unfortunately, Muslims didn't figure out until the 19th century, you know, when abolitionist pressure came from the West. I mean, we should be honest about that. But ultimately, yes, we got it right and we abolished it in the 19th, in some places, even the 20th century, right? That was a time that nobody believed that men and women should have the same rights. Christians didn't think so. Other religious traditions didn't think so. And Muslim scholars didn't think so either. Now, the question is, how much of that historical heritage is universal? How much of that is mere history? If you look into the Quran and read it in its context, you will see that every injunction the Quran brings about women is giving them new rights and saving them from some persecution in that pagan society. But it's not equal. I mean, you can take this either as a destination, as a direction, or you can say it's sealed right there. If we don't say it's sealed right there on slavery, we shouldn't say it's sealed right there on women's issues or on other issues of human rights. So it is there. These ideas are out there. The thing is, in Islam, there is no Vatican to say this is the right Islam. So ultimately, it depends on who you enter Sheikh Google, as they say, and you know you get into different ideas. That's why it's important to produce compelling ideas and to put it out there in the world. And different Islamic groups will form in different parts of the world. There are, in every Muslim society today, there are liberal-leaning, faithful Muslims. They are having conversations, they're translating books, they are learning from each other, they're trying to advance those ideas in their societies, as well as there are more conservative forces, let alone, you know, the extremist forces. So these things will go on, and I think it's a battle of ideas. I mean, that term is used a lot, but it's true. And we, as faithful Muslims, we should do something about this. And I'm doing what I do. I'm not an imam, I'm not a sheikh, I don't issue any fatwa. I mean, I don't claim to, but I think there are pockets of Islamic thought and history that we forgot today and which might open up our minds. And that's why I'm often writing about those. I mean, the Hadith literature, the Kutubi Sitta, the six books, you know, Sahih Bukhari, Muslim, it goes on Tirmizi and so on and so forth. So these are like big collections of Hadiths. They were written down about two centuries after the death of Prophet Muhammad. There were oral traditions before that. There were a lot of forgeries. And these scholars said, okay, we're figuring out the correct ones. We respect those scholars. I'm sure they did their best. But this is human history. It was not a revelation from God. So the idea that if you reject one hadith from Sahih Bukhari, you become a kafir, I mean, that's, to me, ridiculous. I mean, I'm saying this as someone from the Sunni tradition, but we should respect our tradition, but it's not sacred, right? There are a lot of things we will learn from the hadiths. There are a lot of great insights. Without hadiths, we cannot fully understand most what the Quran is speaking about in most cases. But also, we should understand that that's human history. And even the Quran, when the Quran is speaking, to whom the Quran is speaking, I think that's a very important issue. It says, you know, go and it says the people whom you made a treaty. I didn't make a treaty with somebody. It is those first Muslims. It's speaking about their battles. It's speaking about their peace agreements. It is speaking about how they should fight in the battlefield. And that battlefield was there because there was a context to it. Muslims were attacked in the first place, persecuted, and so on and so forth. So not every verse of the Quran is fully applicable today. It is telling Muslims how to enter the house of the Prophet. I can't implement that verse today. I mean, it's not. So we should understand the values that the Quran is upholding. And of course, the religious injunctions like namaz, prayer, fasting, these are universal. But the mu'amilat, the whole social setting, it needs to be reinterpreted. And if you take things written back then, literally today, as applicable, yeah, we will end up with slavery, as some very extreme people are arguing.